Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. If we live to the Lord. And if we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into the world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. Kindly sit as we have the two tributes.
Good evening. As I lay me down, heaven hear me now. I'm lost without a cause, after giving it my all. Winter storms have come and darkened my sun. After all that I've been through, who on earth can I turn to? I look to you. I look to you. After all my strength is gone, in you I can be strong. I look to you. You. I look to you. and the melodies are gone. In you I hear a song, I look to you. About to lose my breath, there's no more fighting left. Sinking to rise no more, searching for that open door. And every road that I've taken led to my regret. And I don't know if I'm gonna make it. Nothing to do but lift my hands. I look to you. I look to you. After all, my strength is gone. In you, I can't be strong. I look to you. To you, and the melodies are gone. In you, I hear a song. I look to you. My levees are broke. The walls have come crumbling down on me. The rain is falling. Defeat is coming. I need you to set me free. Take me far away from the battle. I need you to shine on me. I look to you. I look to you. After all, my strength is gone. In you I can be strong. I look to you. You, I look to you. And the melodies are gone. In you I hear a song. I look to you. I look to you. I look to you.
Good evening. This service we are attending is not only to say goodbye to my father, but we'll also use it to say thank you on behalf of my father, because he know he would request me to do it. Simply because he was the quintessence of gratitude. I will start with Miss Suzanne Barrow. Enough words cannot express how grateful we as a family are to you. His unofficial daughter-in-law, and my mother's adopted daughter, Lisa Evelyn. Miss Bernadette Welch, better known as Kian, for cooking his meals, although he cooked mine and he did use hers first. She made sure he had something to eat every day. Angela Braffitt, Mrs. Linda Boyne, Philip Barrow, Ian Norville, Mr. Alexander, Sheldon Yard. My father had a very special friend who died recently, and I don't believe my father ever recovered from his loss, Mr. Winfield Critchlow, and his wife, Mrs. Jeanette Critchlow, who is thankfully still with us. And I want you to forgive me if any names were forgotten. It wasn't purposely done. Special mention has to be given to my mother, who took exceedingly great care of my father for 53 years of marriage, and I suspect even long before that. And especially in his ailing years, almost single-handedly, she did a Herculean job and did so steadfastly without complaint. All my life, I have known her to be an excellent nurse, but this period where she had to look after my father has endowed me with a more invigorated respect for the nursing profession. My parents loved each other and they guarded their relationship jealously. Never once have I or my siblings have regretted the day that we were blessed with two such great parents. We have lost one now, so Mommy, I want to assure you that we got you. All of us, we have you. Mr. Lionel Leroy Otley, 86 years of Churchview St. John, former foreman of the Barbados Water Authority, was also referred to as the Bird. They understand he got that name because he will be standing over there and he'll be sitting here right then, and 2 seconds later he'd right beside you and they say he had to fly there. Then he was called J.K. Holt, a former cricketer, I don't know who Holt was. I remember one of his former teachers, a man called Colin Dean, who my father sent me to lessons at later in life. I can't believe that he taught my father me too. But he always used to tell me that my father was destined to be a scholar in this country as long as his mother, which is my grandmother, had the money to send him, but she didn't have the money. But he could have gone really far. My father had an insatiable love for music, especially a saxophone, where he played in a few calypso tents and at various events. Somebody was given the opportunity to attend with him, and he loved politics, cricket, and building. His favorite terms were when you got into an argument with him or any of the above, he was not winning the argument, you say, what's the use? And then a lot of times when he got sick and he asked him, how are you feeling? He said, as good as can be, nothing more. It's difficult at best to stand before you and attempt to honor my father in words. It is never an easy task to capture someone's true essence in words. In this instance, I may fall way short of the mark. And it almost feels futile to try. But I have no choice but to try, for this is the last thing I can do for my father while he's above earth. I keep coming back to one thought. Never will you see a man again in life who more faithfully lived his values. As practical as my father was, he still believed great, perhaps impossible things could happen. I could think of no other reason why he would attend me playing cricket or let me drive him as a young man, as reckless as he was. He was a man of extraordinary traits. It was one of the many, many ways that he showed his honesty. To give an example, I remember a guy from Water Authority met me one day and told me, your father is a fool. That obviously brought the ire out of me, but then he explained, your father was in charge of all the building material at Water Authority. He could have built 4 houses out of Water Authority and nobody was asked. And he would not take a grain of sand to take home. If that is his value, his reason for calling him a fool, then I feel that he should be one as well. I was lucky not to have to set my gaze to politicians, sportsmen, or anybody of that. Like, I had my father there, who set a gold standard. And I saw how honesty could father a whole set of other virtues. How it simplifies decisions and invites peace of mind. I believe that all the good decisions I made in my life were as a result of examples set by him. My father was a teacher of all things. His method was simple. He taught by example, and in my eyes, and the eyes of anybody who can see, he was a success. Not financially, but he was a successful man who lived well, laughed often, and loved much, especially his family. He has gained the respect of intelligent men and the love of children. And for his children, he seemingly believed that it is easier to build strong children than to repair broken men. And so, through example, he taught us to be as good as we can be. He has filled his niche and accomplished his tasks, and he has left this world a better place, better than how he found it. He worked very hard, and sometimes I believe too hard. And he did so because the exigencies of having a family demanded it. In his final days here with us, you could hear him calling out the names of his sisters, Patsy and Cynthia, who he loved dearly, and his brothers, who he loved just as dearly. At any age, when faced with an ethical dilemma, after reflection, study, or even rationalization, I find myself coming back to one simple question: what would my father do? His character is the foundation of my conscience. My father was strong in body and in spirit and in commitment. My father was responsible to the very end, to the point where when he realized that he was not in the best of health, he put down the keys and said he's not driving anymore. Not many people do that. My father had a very hearty laugh. Very hearty laugh. And he loved a good joke. Sometimes just now he's leaving home, passed through the living room, I can still hear his laugh as he watched Sanford and Son and Good Times. And he watched them over and over again, and each time he laughed harder as though he said it for the first time. No one on this earth was like my father for me. He was my biggest inspiration and a true hero to me. He never told me how to live my life. He lived his and let me watch him do it. Our family leaned on him during any and all tough times, and he was the rock that never let us down. The strength he possessed was never flashy, in your face, at any point in his life. He was a very quiet and unassuming man who just got on with things. But it was below the surface that his principles and determination laid. That was most evident in how he put his family first and the way he made sure we were protected at every turn. He believed that the strength of a family, like the strength of an army, lies in its loyalty to each other. I say that to say to each and every one of my family members here present, and if you didn't listen for the rest, you wanted to listen to this one, this part. My father had left a legacy of love for his family, of which his brothers and his mother and they made sure that we kept together as a family. And I want to implore all of us, those with children and those even without, to let us get together more often. Because they found that funerals where they should be bringing families together, somehow they tear them apart and people start fighting over land and house and material things that they will go and leave anyhow. So if it's one wish that I want from every one of my family members, is to close that generational gap. From today, let's be closer together. We are close now, but we can be even closer. And I hope that that is something that we can accomplish. And I know that that will make him smile as he looks down on us. It's hard to imagine a life without him. And I will miss him dreadfully. But I was cognizant of the fact that he could not go on forever. And I guess I have made peace with that. But I will forever hold on to the memories I have. He will definitely be missed. But most importantly, he will be remembered. May he rest in peace.
Please stand for the reception of the body. And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother Lionel Nero. We thank you for giving him to us, his family, and friends, to know and love as a father. continue our course on earth until, by your call, we are reunited with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord.
Amen.
May he and all the faithful departed through the mercy of God.
The opening hymn 182.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, your Son, Jesus Christ, who have given us a true faith and a sure hope, strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Please sit for the first Bible reading.
Reading from Revelation of John, chapter 21, beginning at verse 2. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." The word of the Lord.
Amen.
46, congregation, remain seated.
A reading from the Word of God. Today's reading will be taken from John chapter 10, verse 11 to 16. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and they shall be one flock and one shepherd. Here ends the reading.
They call him Jesus. Him before the sermon, 107.
Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. I speak in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Part of the 11th verse of the 10th chapter of the Gospel according to St. John. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. One of the I am sayings of Jesus, and this I am saying here, pointing towards the fulfillment of Old Testament promises by God to shepherd his people Israel. And in this promise, the people will have a great appreciation and understanding of God's love. Jesus, in setting this I am saying here, can serve to bring us the realization of God's love and also of service and commitment to this love of God. And when we think about the love of God being extended to humanity, we can only marvel at how, regardless of how man would move away from the embrace of Almighty God, he will still, as it were, extend the olive branch to welcome and to redeem humanity. And he would make this ultimate sacrifice in giving of his Son for the redemption of all. And it's a love that is referred to as agape love, a love that speaks about sincerity, where we can look past even the hurtful and the wrong things that we might perceive can demolish a relationship and embrace an understanding that as a child of God, it is possible to live, let live, love, and extend goodness in all circumstances. And so this love of God is demonstrated in a sacrificial giving of self when we're able to do things for the right reasons. When we're able to reach out to a brother or sister in love, regardless to whether we know them or not, and be able to let God's love reign supreme through our actions. Let it be an experience. Let God reveal himself through the efforts. And when we think about loving this unconditional way, and we think about such love in this materialistic world in which we live in, we can lose the mark of truly appreciating God's love. For this materialistic world in which we live in will sometimes devalue the understanding of love and put us to the point where people will love or claim to love you depending on what is in it for me. People seem to be able to give of their best if they know that something is there for me. And if there's nothing there, well, then maybe it doesn't make sense. And this world in which we live in teaches us this. And it introduces into relationships an element of selfishness where we are unable to appreciate and to see each other as brothers and sisters and be able to respond to them in their time of need. This love of God demonstrated through the relationship that Jesus the Christ will have and his life and ministry that he would display among the people will see him going about and doing good in all circumstances, even when he was rejected, even when he was persecuted, he was still able to remain focused on his task, focused on his purpose in this life, and do good to all. And we thank God for such an example in the life of Jesus the Christ. And through this love also, and presenting himself to the community as the good shepherd, the people will appreciate the understanding of the extent of his love. For in the farming or the community at that time, the shepherd was the one who was always there to not only lead, protect, and look out for the flock, but he was there to make sure that everything was completed. He was there to make sure that he tried hard not to lose any one of them. So much so that if one was to go astray, it was not a simple case of just forgetting it and moving on. It was about gathering. It was about being there and allowing them to be one, to be able to share together and experience his care, his love, and his affection for them. And through the ministry of Jesus, we see how he interacted with people over and over again. And his interactions in times was able to provide the hope for the hopeless, the comfort for those who were afflicted, and the strength to those who were down and out because of the life conditions in which they were enduring. And as we gather here this evening to give Almighty God thanks for the life and witness of our departed brother Lionel, we do so with an understanding that our appreciation for God's love can find us keeping the prayerful support alive for him as we entrust him to the safekeeping of this God of love, this God who would pardon the transgressions, and this God who will receive him as one of his own. And as we do this and commend him to Almighty God, it will be good for us to take time out and to probably ask ourselves the question this evening after hearing the tribute of our departed brother Lionel, and ask the question, who will carry on from where he would have left off? And especially in the family circle, who will be that person to ensure that the love, the agape love, will still remain the binding force within the family? Who would carry on that caring and sharing relationship? And who will be that person that will keep the ship together and, like the shepherd, lead them into greener pastures? So that question is for the family. And as you wrestle with the question, be assured that it will not be an easy task. But again, embracing and looking towards the life example that he would have set before, to allow the memories that you would have had of him to so shape your response to life that you can use even those bitter occasions, those occasions that would have made you angry, and allow them to shape your response to each other and to life going forward. For the memories that you would have had or that you have of your departed loved one will be personal memories. And there will be memories that some of them will bring joy. Some of them will bring hurt and anger and even pain. But they are the memories that would have made you who you are today, and the memories that you can learn from and hope to improve on where there is necessary for improvement, and to continue to let live and reign supreme within the setting. And when you are able to do this, the whole act of laying the mortal remains to rest will just be one aspect of this service of thanksgiving. But the life and the legacy will live on. It will live on as we continue to be a people of love, where we can share and care for each other more, where we can embrace an understanding of God working through us in special ways to allow his love to be experienced, and be not selfish that we reserve from giving of our best in all relationships. It would mean divorcing ourselves from the understanding of the love portrayed in the world. For the love portrayed in this world and doing anything with service is one very much based on Hollywood. It is also a love that can really present you as a fool. For we experience in relationships how we can give of our best, how we can be sincere and committed in our giving, our sharing, and our caring, and still be taken advantage of. So this world says to us that love, the L-O-V-E, agape love, is now moved to the level of what society and probably mothers will know of very well, the love that is spelled L-U-V. You ever heard about that one? And it's a true L-U-V. And if you take, for example, what it is used for, you will understand that kind of love and how damaging it could be. That love is a pamper. Yes, it's comfort, but you use me, and when you finish with me, you discard me. And that is what happens sometimes in this world, where we take people for granted and we do not cherish and respect the efforts that they will give and present to us in community. We take them for granted. Also, the Hollywood love that we are very much accustomed to is one that says to us, what is in it for me? What is in it for me? And it can only manifest itself when we give people material things. We only have to think about relationships. A lady looked to her better half, her spouse. Darling, do you love me? Well, yes, you know I love you. Everything I provide here for you, you know I love you. You're my working hard, you know, doing everything possible. But the love still seemed to be missing something. And this love that is missing something is just so simple. Sometimes it means so much to just hear the words, I love you. So you can give me every single thing. You can do every single thing possible. But let us not just take for granted the simple words that we can say to people, and especially when they can hear it and appreciate it, that I love you. When we do this, when we allow people to hear and not only hear that we love them, they can really, really lift them from wherever they are at, especially when they're down and out, and be very much conscious of being loved as a child of God. And with service, I want us to think about the service that Jesus would have given and the service that our brother Leroy would have given to the Water Authority in his working. Service based on sincerity and honesty. We are in a situation, I hope we recognize it, where we beg for service these days. We beg for service. And the people who are there, who are supposed to give the service, especially to the most vulnerable, sometimes believe that it is their God-given right to decide who is to get service. And the quality of service is deteriorating rapidly in this island. That I don't know about you, but I sometimes feel that I'm begging even though I'm paying. You're treated like dirt sometimes when it comes to service. Even to try to get a problem solved nowadays in this technological world, you cannot hear anyone that you can communicate with and direct you. So you want to report a problem, probably to a service provider for some bad service you get in. If you know the extension of the person you're trying to reach, press 1. And you press 1, that person is busy. Listen to this music. We'll take your call in order. And you're still waiting. You're still waiting. That frustration sets in. And it's only a matter of time before you put down and you're frustrated with whatever is happening. But we call it progress. We call it progress while service is being devalued. And when it comes to service again, you see this thing about honesty? I wonder how many really consider giving an honest day's work. An honest day's work, where through our honesty, more people might be able to benefit. And then service becomes a reality to shape and improve our lives as a people. It is not about self. It is about living in community, respecting and caring for each other, and giving God thanks for the opportunity. Amen. Your response to the bidding, Lord, in your mercy, shall be, hear our prayer. Hear our prayer.
Let us pray with confidence to God our Father, who raised our Lord Jesus from the dead for the salvation of all. Grant, Lord, that your servant may know the fullness of life which you have promised to those who love you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Be close to those who mourn. Increase their faith in your undying love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
May we be strengthened in our faith. Live the rest of our lives in fellowship with your Son, and be ready when you call us to the fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Show your mercy to the dying, strengthen them with hope, and fill them with the peace and joy of your presence. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend all people to your unfailing love, that in them your will may be fulfilled, and we rejoice at the faithful witness of your saints in every age, praying that we share with them in your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Father of all, we pray to you for Lionel, of all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. And may he and all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. I take this opportunity to extend sincere condolences on behalf of the parish family here at St. John, the Reverend Susan Ellis, also the Reverend Dr. Marcus Lashley and family, and assure you of our prayerful support in this, your time of bereavement. Please remain standing for the commendation. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind, and we are mortal, form of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Let us commend our brother Lionel to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Deliver your servant, Lionel, O sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil, and set him free from every bond, that he may rest with all your saints in eternal habitations, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Lionel. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen.
gives to me will come to me. I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give new life to our mortal bodies through his indwelling spirit. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this. Happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. In the midst of life we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but to you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins? Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins, and at our last hour, let us not fall away from you.
In sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our brother Lionel, and we commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved Son shall come again in judgment, both this our brother Lionel and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants who, having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. May we, with all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, raise us, we humbly pray, from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, that when we depart this life, we may rest in him, and at the resurrection receive that blessing which your well-beloved Son shall then pronounce. Come, you blessed of my Father, receive the kingdom prepared for you from the beginning of the world. Grant this, O merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, our mediator and redeemer. Amen. Amen. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Number 491, 491.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Hymn number 497.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a fullness of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washing His blood. This is my story, this is my song.
Have been our refuge from one generation to another. Before the mountains were brought forth, or the land and the earth were born, from age to age, you are God. You turn us back to the dust and say, go back, O child of earth. For a thousand years in your sight are like yesterday when it is past, and like a watch in the night. You sweep us away like a dream. We fade away suddenly like the grass. In the morning, it is green and flourishes. In the evening, it is dried up and withered. For we consume away in your displeasure. We are afraid because of your wrathful indignation. Our iniquities you have set before you, and our secret sins in the light of your countenance. When you are angry, all our days are gone. We bring our years to an end like a sigh. The span of our life is 70 years, perhaps in strength even 80. Yet the sum of them is but labor and sorrow. For they pass away quickly, and we are gone. Who regards the power of your wrath? Who rightly fears your indignation? So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to wisdom. Return, O Lord. How long will you tarry? Be gracious to your servants. Satisfy us by your loving kindness in the morning. So shall we rejoice and be glad all the days of our life. Make us glad by the measure of the days that you afflicted us, and the years in which we suffered adversity. Show your servants your works and your splendor to their children. May the graciousness of the Lord our God be upon us. Prosper the work of our hands. Prosper our handiwork.
Next hymn, It Is Well With My Soul, hymn 757, and I want to hear the men especially in the chorus. So men that have a leaflet and listening to you in the chorus.
Make peace like a river attend and my way, and sorrow I see billows roll.
Final hymn, To God Be the Glory, hymn 387.
So love is the word that he gave.
atonement for sin. And open the light, that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, to Jesus the Son. And give him the glory. Redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer, the promise of God, the violence of anger, who truly believes, that moment from Jesus, a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. And greater rejoicing to Jesus the Son, the purer and higher and greater will be. Our wonder, our rapture when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, to Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let people rejoice.
No, a black one.
Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious unto him. The Lord lift his countenance upon him and give him peace. And unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. Amen. May his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the tender mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen.
Let me hear the worshipers! Where's all of my praises? I want everybody around the world to put your hands together, because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go.
Every praise
is to our God.
praise him now. He's worthy of the praise. I don't care what you've been through. Just know that praise is bringing you out right now. Nobody can get